We have a lot to praise the Lord about. So this morning, I just want to praise God, praise God, praise God, that He hears our prayers. We're going to talk today about the power of prayer and the fact that we can go to our Heavenly Father, who is a good, good Father, and He will hear our prayers and He will respond. So welcome to Restoration Ministries and our service today. I'm glad that you're joining us. Today, we have a praise report. To let you know that our little grandson, who spent a week in the NICU unit, is out. He was given a clean bill of health. Logan Daniel Newman entered the world on October the 8th, and we were excited to have the chance to be there and spend time with our granddaughters. His sisters, who are now all older sisters and all have a little brother, and so we are just happy to talk about that. But today, we wanted to let you know that we trusted in the report of the Lord, that we felt the uplifting of prayers as we were going through that situation. Little Logan was born, and he came 3 weeks early due to some complications that mom was having. But he came, and when he came out, we were actually on the road, and the report given to us was he got a 9 on the APGAR score, which is near perfect. Just a few short hours later, there were some complications, and little Logan found himself in the NICU unit, primarily with issues regarding one lung. But those moments, obviously, are moments of uncertainty, moments where emotions run high, moments where there's challenge in your mind and a battle begins to wage. But we've called the prayer warriors in our lives and our families. And thank God for people who are willing to intercede, who are willing to step and stand in the gap. So today, I want to talk and share with you about the power of prayer, about God's providence that is demonstrated in our lives, that we have personally experienced here recently through prayer that we have submitted to God on our own, but also the prayer of warriors around literally all over the world who were praying for us and our little grandson. And praise God for His good report. So just as a visual, I wanted to start out, and for those that are watching via video, this might be a little challenging to see, but I've got a picture here of what I would say the power of prayer looks like. And so what I have that you're looking at is a picture of Mimi Tracy. That's what the grands all call Tracy is Mimi, mostly because she demands that. Granny was not going to work for her. And so this is her actually holding little Logan a little bit less than a week ago in the NICU. This was actually after he had gotten some of the oxygen and the things removed from his body. But what I wanted to illustrate here was this special picture, which is special to my heart because there's two special people in it. But I wanted to just share with you that when we pray, this is kind of what it looks like. If we are submitting ourselves and we actually are in the position of Logan, even if we cannot be with those who are praying for us, this is what I believe the Spirit of God, what Jesus Himself, what God the Father is doing with us. He's holding us close against His face, so that we can hear every word that is said, and He's providing this comfort. And as we pray, even though physically we may not feel this, I believe that in the Spirit there is this embracing, this comfort, the peace that given to us that passes all understanding. And so I want to give you this visual, and then the result kind of is what you see in our little Logan here, is this little grin, just this look of great peace. Even though this little guy is in the middle, and even in this picture, in the NICU unit, in the midst of a storm, in the midst of the troubles, trials, tribulations of this world, amidst disease, sickness, financial, emotional, relational challenges that we experience in our life, I believe that we can receive the comfort of God. And I believe that we receive that as we pray. But you know, sometimes, just like here, you know, little Logan doesn't have words to say. And have you ever been in a situation where your situation is overwhelming you to a place where it's like you can't find the words to pray? Well, thank God in those moments that we have Jesus the Son, we have the Holy Spirit, we have God the Father to help us through that. We're going to dive into that today. But also that we have people willing to intercede on our behalf. And so today I want to walk through this very powerful dynamic of communication that God has given us through the power of prayer. So, prayer and intercession. So what is prayer? I mean, obviously we all, I think, know what prayer is. I've got a little definition that I've written here. A solemn request for help or an expression of thanks that's addressed to Almighty God. So the prayer is the primary method of our communication. God created us in His image that we would have a relationship with us. He gave us a voice that we can express words that He expects us to use in dialogue with Him. Prayer is a primary method of communication with God. Prayer is the intentional reaching out to connect with God. Prayer is very intentional. Prayer is action. Prayer is not sitting idly by and not taking action to do something, but prayer is engaging intentionally with dialogue with our God. Think of the honor that really is. God, who created everything you see, everything around us, wants for you to speak with Him and for Him to speak with you. The avenue by which we do that is prayer. It is the act of making ours or others, in the case of intercessions, needs known before God. The Bible says that many times we have not because we ask not. If we don't ask, we're not going to get an answer. If we don't cry out to Him, He knows all things, but His expectation is that we communicate with Him. It's our act of making ours and others' concerns known to God. It's one way. And really, let's go back on that. It's more of like submitting those things and surrendering those things from our authority and control to God's authority. If God already knows, He doesn't necessarily need to hear the words. He wants to. He wants us to be in dialogue. But the reality is we're saying those prayers so we can hear those words, so we can think about those things, so we can renew and transform our minds to align with Him. And we build a conduit, a highway of communication with our Lord and God, Lord God. It's one way that we express thanks, adoration, and praise is through our prayer. In fact, we're going to talk about the Lord's Prayer. We're going to talk about some elements of that, where first we begin the prayer with acknowledging who God is and how great He is. How great Thou art, O Lord. Prayer is the method by which we confess our shortcomings, and it's the place that we request forgiveness. Thank God that He sent His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us, to take our place on a cross. And now He gives us opportunity, because Jesus did what He did, because He then went down into the pits of hell, got the keys of hell and the grave and death, and captured those. Then He came and the veil was torn that was separating us from God. Jesus made that way. And so that way that opens the door for us to say, when we fall short, when we stumble, when we sin, we can go to God and we can confess to Him those things that we've done. You know, I have a daughter. Her name is Lindsay Kay. She has a daughter whose name is Emmy Sage. And she has this thing that she's done since she could walk and talk, that Lindsay is brutally honest about anything that she did, even as a little kid. She would always ask about consequences. We would explain to her what the consequences were, much like the Word of God is given to us about, here's the guidebook, here's the rules, this is what you do, this is what you don't do, and if you do something that's against this book, you have consequences. So the same way is what we were doing with our daughter as we raised her, telling her, these are the consequences. If you take this action, you're going to get this punishment. Lindsay was the type that would say, okay, and then directly what you told her not to do, she would go right in front of you and do it if she wanted to. And then she would come back, and she, as a little girl, less than two, I suppose, would look at her mommy's eyes and say, thank me, mommy, I did something that you told me not to do. She was so honest. But God, I would just put it to you today that God just wants us to live our lives honestly before Him. He wants us to be at a place where we can honestly and boldly approach Him even when we've fallen. The enemy would like to keep you isolated. The enemy would like to say, oh, you've done something so bad, you've done something so awful that you can't possibly go to God with that. You should be embarrassed. You have now committed the sin that God cannot pardon. And what is that? It's nothing but a lie. Lindsay grasped that situation with us, her parents, on earth, that she knew there would be punishment, but she knew above all that we loved her, that we cared for her, and that we were looking out for her best interests. And even though she had disobeyed, even though she had done something that was warranting punishment, she came to us because we had an open piece of dialogue constantly with our daughter of trust, of love, of care and affection for one another, that she could say, even if I've done wrong, I know I can go to my dad, and I know that I may be punished, but I know he's doing it because he's looking out for my good. God is looking out for our good. Prayer is the way that opens the door for us not to remain silent and live and dwell in the muck, the mire, the sin of our lives, but allows us to boldly approach him and ask for mercy. Ask for grace because of what his son Jesus did. Prayer is the place that we have communion with God. It's the place of most intimate fellowship. It's the place where God commits to us the covenants that he's given in his word and through his son Jesus. And we give covenant back to him that we make these commitments that we're going to be loyal, we're going to be faithful, we're going to serve him, and if we fall, we're going to go and ask for forgiveness. But it's the place of the most intimate communion that we can have with God. Prayer is the place where we listen. Sometimes a prayer, if you're not praying in this way, if you're not praying in a way that allows God to reciprocate, allows God to speak, allows God to answer the petition that you presented, you might want to just try this and just be quiet before the Lord. Humble yourself. Put yourself in a place where distractions are taken away. That's hard in our world. It's hard in our environment. For Tracy and I, we like to go to the woods. We like to grab our hammocks and go to where no one else is at. And if it's by the water, even better. And we like to stretch those hammocks out and just be quiet before God. And nearly every time, when we've silenced ourselves enough, as we've gone out and we've begin to praise him and praise him for all the things that he's given us. We also take a moment to be quiet, to quiet our bodies, to quiet our minds, and just to ask, Lord, speak to me. Speak to me, Lord. Your child is here. I'm listening, Lord. Prayer is the place that we can say, Lord, please speak to me. Please tell me. Please show me. Sometimes we get so busy, we don't quiet ourselves long enough in a place of prayer and a posture of humble humility before our God that we don't allow him opportunity to speak into our lives. Prayer is the place that we can do that. So what about intercession? I looked up all of the words in Greek and Hebrew in the Bible. There's multiple references, mostly in the New Testament, but one in the Old Testament. But the words, as I combined the meanings in the Greek and studied all of the words, basically I paraphrased all that. This is the Strong's Concordance condensed according to Jeff. But this is what I came up with. Intercession is to reach out on behalf of another in prayer to address an issue that requires divine intervention from God in order to resolve it. It's reaching out before another in prayer to address an issue, a concern, a tragic thing in someone's life that requires divine intervention from God to resolve. If the truth be known, more things in our life actually require divine intervention. But sometimes because of our own pride, our own intellect, our own logic, we can try to take on way more than God ever intended us to. When God says he will not give you more than you can stand, more than you can handle, more than you can take, he means it. But sometimes if we don't surrender it to him, it can feel like we're in an overwhelming situation. When we find ourselves in that place, I pray that each of us have people in our lives that are willing to intercede. To intercede means to stand in the gap. As I mentioned, there are times in our lives where you can be just so distraught with situations, circumstances, and the things that are going on in your life that you can't even find the words to pray. You fall short of being able to say, you know, God. And sometimes you can just cry out. And we have a dear friend who's one of my mentors, Jerry Lawson. He just had a birthday. Happy birthday, Jerry. And he put himself in a prayer closet. And all he said, all he could say for a period of time, quite a bit of time, was, God, I love you. God, I love you. Here recently, I was going through a season of life where I was studying, I was looking, I was talking to God about ministry. There was all kinds of things happening in our family that were very challenging, mostly regarding health, health of us, health of family members, so forth. And I couldn't find a lot of words, and I kept going to the scripture. I kept spending time before him, and God just gave me these words. He says, Jeff, do you trust me? Jeff, do you trust me? Jeff, do you trust me? And my answer was yes, but he kept asking, he kept asking. And so my prayer, the only thing that I could come up with was, God, I trust you. God, I trust you. God, I trust you. And I believe God honors those places we're at. But in those seasons, you need to have people in your life. You need to have a community around you who can intercede, who can go before God on your behalf and be the person who stands in the gap. Intercession is intentionally positioning oneself between God and man as a conduit. As you're in the gap with whoever you're praying for and God, you're looking and saying, Lord, I want to be a vessel. I want to be that conduit that allows your voice to flow through me to get to this person. I'm going to be the person who says the prayers that maybe they can't because they don't have the words to say. I want, Lord God, to be the person who fights the war and fights the battle in prayer. We surrender the battle to God. The battle is not ours to fight. But we surround ourselves with people who are willing to call down the forces of heaven to defend that which is being violated in the natural. To have intercession is to remain steadfast while humbly making petitions to God Almighty. Intercessors have this great call in their life, but they need to be consistent. They need to be constant. They need to be steady. My grandson, I don't know where he got this from, and maybe it's from his father or their side of the family, I'm not sure, but it's really cute. Whenever he's getting ready to do something, he always says, instead of saying ready, set, go, he says ready, steady, go. An intercessor is just that. They're ready. They're positioned to do what they need to do, and they're steady. They're stable. They're consistent. They're going to be trustworthy, and they're going to go through that. And then they're going to go. They're going to do. They're going to take action. Being an intercessor is being steadfast, but also being humble. If my people, the Bible says, call upon my name, humble themselves and fast and pray, then you will hear from heaven, and he will heal their land. Humility is a very important aspect of intercession. Intercession is to be the catalyst for addressing the significant needs in the lives of others. It's really making that connection. Oftentimes, as you intercede or people who are interceding for you, many times they will feel the same emotions, in some cases the same physical stress. If you're praying for someone sometimes and they have a breathing condition, sometimes the Lord will allow you to even feel or experience that. Supernaturally, God will show you what you need to pray for. Because remember, the battle is not here on earth. You can do battle and look and pray about the things you physically see, but God will reveal things in the spirit that will give you the keys towards victory. And that's what intercessor is enabling for that person to do. So my family experienced this power this last week. As our grandson, I mentioned, was 3 weeks early. And you know, there's this great joy. He came out and it's like, wow, he's a 9 out of 10 on the Apgar. His weight was good. His length was really good. He looked awesome. He was holding on. He started to nurse right away. Everything looked good, and within a couple of hours, all that changed. But when the prayers of God's people in intercession, the powerful prayers of the church, of our family, of those people who are in relationship with us were lifted up, I'm so proud of my daughter and my son-in-law and their family and our whole family. There was no sense of panic. There was always this blessed assurance that we were going to be okay, that Logan was going to be okay. There was never a doubt. And there was just this overwhelming, for me, I'll speak for myself, this place of comfort, this place of peace, despite the fact that we'd driven halfway across or more of the United States. And because he's in the NICU, we're only allowed to see him for minutes of time. So within the first 3 days of his life, the grand total of time that I actually got to see him, physically see him and be in the room with him, was about 20 minutes. But somehow, the Prince of Peace, the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, had caused us to be calm. Had caused us to have rest. And I was even looking this morning, and I don't always sleep so well. And so in this environment, you would think I would even sleep more poorly. But actually, on average, I slept better last week, than I've slept in over a month. In the midst of a storm, in the midst of a trial, in the midst of circumstances, which obviously had great cause for concern, I would argue that because of the prayers of faithful people, because of our prayers being lifted up, that God responded and gave us that peace. We felt those prayers. Those prayers were effective. Those prayers made a difference. And so we felt the power of prayer. We felt that peace. We felt that comfort. And so today, I want to talk to us about experiencing that same thing. And I want to talk to us about the elements of prayer. So first, we're going to talk about prayer being the source of power. The examples of intercession. So God, we know, one of his names is actually Jehovah Jireh, our provider. God provides the answers when we have questions. God provides a solution when we don't know how to make a way. God, I would share with you, gives you the puzzle piece when you don't know what the next piece is, or you don't know what the big picture is looking like. And I'll just share with you, this is, some of you may think this is odd, but I believe God uses kind of strange and unusual ways to communicate. Maybe it's just to us because we're strange and unusual. I don't know. But for the past, how long, Trace?
Couple years.
2 years or more, God has given us in the most random places, parking lots, grocery stores, wherever, the latest puzzle piece. We literally find pieces of the puzzle. And this is significant for us because we keep praying about, God, show us your way, reveal to us our path. And each time we find a little puzzle piece, it's like, what are you showing us, God? You're showing us another piece. You're showing us another direction. You're making the picture become more clear. And so we found a puzzle piece on the ledge of the waiting room, I believe, in the hospital. And there are some things that meant to us that were very important. But God is our provider. He is our solution. God is for us. And he will put the puzzle pieces of our life together. When we feel like we have chaos, he will bring order. So turn to me, if you will, to Romans. We're going to, as per usual, we're going to be in the Word a lot. You can tell I've got my Bible ready to bounce through the Word about what he has to say about prayer. This is not an exhaustive study, but just a high level what we're going to do in the time we have. Romans 8, 26-39. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray as we ought, but the Spirit itself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also him graciously give us? With him give us all things. Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is it to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. So who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation? Shall distress? Persecution, famine, nakedness, danger, or sword, as it is written, for your sake, we are being killed all day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No! In all things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Man, that's got a lot of stuff in it. There's a lot of things that are good news that are contained within that scripture. So first of all, you heard the word intercession multiple times in that scripture. Multiple times you heard the word intercession. So I want to talk about the sources of power. We're talking about the power of prayer today. First of all, the source of power is the Spirit. When we are weak, the Bible says, then the Spirit is strong. The Spirit intercedes, it says, for us. When we have no words to say, the Spirit gives us words to address our situation. When we have no words to say and we can't even hear, and to get those words, it says the Spirit will utter groanings that are undetectable by human words. And why is that? I believe that that is because we aren't battling in this carnal world. We aren't battling with carnal words. We're battling with spiritual forces, and we're getting and receiving from the Spirit intercession that is speaking words that fight the spiritual battle. We don't wrestle or contend with our flesh and blood, but against principalities, forces, and spiritual places. So if our weapons are not carnal, then certainly there are times when our words to fight the battle may not be of this world, but instead that they are sourced, they are provided by the Spirit. Intercession occurs when another is going to God on our behalf. And in this case, we can be rest assured that a source of power for the believer is that the Spirit makes intercession for you. But how does that happen? First, there has to be relationship with the Spirit. We have to be connected. We have to allow permissively the Spirit to come in. Think about that. The Holy Spirit, a member of the Godhead, the Trinity, is directly communicating with God the Father on our behalf. Have you ever played that telephone game? You know, either as an adult or as a kid. It's kind of funnier as an adult. But you know, you tell the message and you say, their shoelaces are red. And by the time it goes to about 10 people, by the time it's at the end, it's like the monkey jumped off the bridge. And it's like, all the message gets miscommunicated because it goes through all these different hands. This passage of scripture in Romans is saying, no, no, no. You have the Spirit. as a direct line of communication. I'll date myself here. Does anybody watch Batman, the originals? Well, in the Batcave, there was a thing called the Bat Phone. The Bat Phone had no other line but to one source. One source. The source of information, the source of power, the source of direction. And in our case, this scripture is pointing to the fact that the Spirit can be that one source going directly to the Father. So the Spirit's purpose in intercession is to facilitate the prayers that will assure that all things are working for our good. That's powerful. That's power in prayer. The Spirit Himself is interceding. So when we cry out and say, Lord, I don't know the words to say, Spirit, would you please help me? That engages this process where the Spirit is going and interceding for you on your behalf because you're a child of God. And the Spirit looks down and says, this child is not being treated as they should. They are not being treated as someone in the kingdom. They're being buffeted, attacked. They're being deprived of their rights. So he's going to the Father saying, we've got a problem. God, I need you to intervene. And the Spirit's speaking directly to God the Father, assuring all things are working for our good. The Spirit's intercession is also continually conforming us into the image of Jesus that we might fulfill our calling and obtain the ultimate glory that's found via eternal salvation. The power over death is powerful. The power over hell, the power over the grave that's provided by Jesus. The Spirit allows us to walk in a place of communion with God, in relationship with God on a daily basis. Jesus said to his disciples, I go, I will not be with you much longer, but I go to the Father to sit on the right-hand side. But rest assured, have comfort, have peace, understand, I'm sending you another, the Spirit, the Comforter, the one who will guide, the one who will direct, the one who will lead. He said, there's many more things I need to speak to you, to his disciples. But I'm not going to have time to do that in this realm. But don't worry, the Spirit will come to you and reveal all things. And the Spirit does not speak of his own accord. He only speaks what he knows of the Father. So you're getting a direct intervention from God through the Spirit. Through the intercession of the Spirit, we receive power. The second verse part I want to talk about that's captured in this scripture in Romans is about Jesus. And Jesus, when we talk about the power that he gives us, it's through the power of love. When we were kids, I think it was Huey Lewis, maybe, sang the power of love. There's a song, this little boppy song that danced around. But there is power in love. Love that was provided through the ultimate expression on the cross. No greater love has anyone in this than someone who lays down their life, and exactly that is what Jesus did. It's the knowledge and comfort knowing that God of creation loves you so much that he gave his son Jesus. That's powerful. And it should therefore empower us to exist with confidence, with joy, with assurance that when we talk to him through prayer, he will listen and he will answer. The power of love is provided through relationship and gives us a new identity because of what Jesus did, and because if we've asked him into our heart to be our Lord and Savior, we're living for him, we then, the Bible says, become joint heirs with Jesus himself. Because of his great sacrifice, we become sons and daughters of God Almighty. That's powerful. Those of you who are parents, you empower your children with all of the things that you have. Your child will get to drive a different kind of car, whatever you are able to provide. You will live in a certain house of whatever you can provide. But it's nothing that that child has done or earned. It's given because you love them. As we enter into relationship with Jesus, we then become a son of God with rights and privileges. We receive an inheritance on this, in this earth and in this life, but also eternally. You are chosen, the Bible says. You are God's elect. You are exempt from condemnation. The Bible says there is therefore no more condemnation. If you're feeling condemned, that's someone else. That's something else. That's the enemy coming against you. It's not that you won't be convicted. There's a difference. But you will not be condemned. This is if we walk in his power that Jesus has provided, and that we will receive understanding. Jesus himself, the Bible says in this passage, he intercedes for us, literally sitting at the right hand of the Father, talking to God the Father on your and my behalf. Wow. That's powerful. That is powerful. So why wouldn't we pray to Jesus? Why wouldn't we pray in the Spirit, knowing that both have direct lines and access to God the Father? We can pray to God the Father. We can come boldly, it says, before him. But Jesus will intercede for us. He provides us with power and security. It says here, nothing can separate us from the power of love that's found in Christ Jesus. Nothing can separate you. We can feel separated. We can feel isolated. We can feel that we're not apart. But Jesus himself intercedes for us and puts us in a position where the Bible says later in this text, you are more than conquerors. That means you're not just winning, you're overcoming. You're capturing, you're taking back, you're getting increase beyond where you were before. So through the love and the intercession of Jesus, we also have power. We're talking about the power of prayer. We just talked about the power that we have because of the relationship and the intercession of Jesus and the intercession of the Holy Spirit. Now we're going to talk about prayer. When we stay connected to the source of power. So power, right? For us to have power, for my microphone to work right now, we had to plug in the speaker. We had to plug in the little wireless thing. We had to put a battery in here. We had to be plugged in. We had to be engaged at the source so that we would have power. So if we want to stay plugged into the source of power that we get through prayer, we naturally want to stay plugged into the supernatural true source from which that power comes. The method for us staying connected with God, the source of all power, is via prayer. The Bible says a whole lot about prayer, so let's just explore a few examples of our call to pray. So let's go to Philippians 4, and we're going to read 4 through 7. Philippians 4, 4 through 7. And it says, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything. We just went through that a couple weeks ago. But in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and guard your minds in Christ Jesus. Rejoice, it says in the Lord. Always rejoice in everything by prayer and supplication. Supplication is the act of going humbly before God. If you look the word up in the scripture, it refers to the word begging. And saying, God, please address my situation. Please intervene. Please interject. Prayer is looking and saying, we will make our lifestyle be that of prayer, and it won't be a mystery to God what our needs are. Now, he already knows before we ask, but the Bible is so emphatic about the importance of us communicating in this way to God, to be praying about everything. prayer squelches anxiety. We all have anxious moments. Things happen in our life. We have emotions. We shouldn't suppress them. But the reality is that if it starts to become consuming, the Bible says that prayer will squelch that. Prayer is the action of dialogue with God, making our concerns known, asking Him questions, thanking Him for His goodness, telling Him our concern, seeking direction. And we need to always keep mindful of this. Some of us have not had great experiences with earthly parents, earthly fathers. I am not one of those people. However, I've known many who either don't have a dad, or it would seem in the natural it would be better if they didn't because their dads were abusive, verbally, mentally, physically, what have you. But whatever your context or whatever your definition of God, you need to reframe it and restructure it into what a good father looks like. So a good father, you can trust. A good father, you can place hope in. A good father will give good gifts. A good father will leave an inheritance. A good father will provide protection and security. This is what God the Father does. God the Father is all-knowing. So if we have something we need answered, a question, a concern, we're in a situation, He knows the answer. He knows the future. He designed us with a specific plan. So Him knowing all the answers, we should go to Him. We should talk to Him. We should make everything within us known. It says in the Bible that He numbers the hairs on our head. Mine are fleeting. So we've got several theories with the grandchildren. We have a hot lava theory. We have a barber theory. We have I rode my bike so fast the wind took it off theory. All of these are great thoughts about the loss of my hair. But here's the point. God knows that every single one that fell off in the shower this morning. And He cares for you so intimately. It says, look at my nature, look at my creation. If I care for the birds, if I care for the fields, if I care for the flowers, if I care for all of that, how much more you created in His image does He care for you? So when you care for someone, one of the most important things that you can do to nurture that relationship is to communicate. Tracy and I, for years, have done a lot of counseling, a lot of marriage counseling. There's several factors that typically lead to the demise of a marriage, and one of the very top ones is a lack of communication, a misunderstanding of each other. This communication is significant. It's so important that not just with our spouses and our families, but God is our Father. We should talk to Him. We should joyfully have exchanges of dialogue with Him. He's got the roadmap for our lives. When we talk to Him, we can get all tangled up and be having thoughts about it's some mystical thing and all this kind of thing. But you know, you don't always have to close your eyes when you talk to God. I mean, our typical, what we learn as a child, right? Our posture of prayer, fold your hands, bow your head, close your eyes. All of that's good. I think we do that because we want to take away the visual distractions and keep focused on God. We want to put our hands, my daughter, youngest daughter, tells her kids when they put their hands like this, it's in self-control. So we want to go before God, we want to control all the external things, and we want to quiet those things so that we can hear Him, so that we can communicate with Him, and that's great. But I also want to say that it's okay that as you're walking through the mall, that you say, God, speak to me. Tell me what you'd like me to do today. Bring along someone to my path, Lord God, that can share your goodness. Or maybe He is speaking to you. Maybe He tells you, see that person over there? You need to talk to them. As we were in the hospital in the NICU, you know, you see a lot of different things. You see families going through tragic circumstances, situations. You know, in dire straits. You know, and on several occasions, as Tracy and I were in there, we receive peace and comfort because of prayers of people who were interceding on our behalf, because prayers we had submitted, because of our faith in the true God, God allowed us in those moments, this isn't trying to brag in any way, but to speak to us to say, why don't you pray with that person? Why don't you go see what's going on? I mean, you can see, obviously, there's emotional stress and so forth. But the reality is, in that moment, when the things and life could have been just totally overwhelming for us, God saw fit enough to give us enough strength, to give us enough power, to give us enough courage, to give us enough recognizing situation to be go to some other person and to extend his love. It's not the strength of Tracy. It's not the strength of me. It's about God Almighty loving his children and working through us. So at the same time, some of you are interceding for us. God put us in a position where we could return back and give back and intercede for others. God is a mighty God, a powerful God, overcoming situations. He's relational. He wants a conversation relationally. He wants a real conversation. He loves you, and he loves you unconditionally. He wants to hear your voice, and he wants to speak to you so you can hear his. Let's turn secondly to James. We're talking about prayer. James 5, and we're going to read 13 through 16. James, this is one of my favorite books. One of my life verses comes from this book. I love the book of James. James 5, verses 13 through 16. It says, is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing praise, another form of prayer. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins one to another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. In other words, the version says the prayer of a righteous man is effectual. It's effective. James instructs us here to pray in many circumstances. Are you suffering? Pray. If you're cheerful and happy, give praise. What does it say? In whatever situation, as we read in the Philippians verses, in everything, pray. When you're sick, pray with the elders, anointing with oil. When you have sin, pray for forgiveness. The prayers of the righteous, what are they? They're powerful. We're talking about the power of prayer, and they're effective. We should have confidence in that. Not to say that tragic events don't happen. Not to say that when we're praying for a miracle, sometimes it doesn't occur the way we see it. But the Bible says, don't be double-minded. Pray in faith, believing that you'll receive your answer. So as we were interceding and people were interceding for us about Logan, those prayers were powerful. Those prayers were effective. So what's your situation today? What do you need intercession for? Who or what are you interceding and standing in the gap for? If you're an intercessory person, if you take on the burdens of other people and you pray for them, you need someone to be praying for you, because it can become overwhelming. If you try to take it on your own strength, on your own power, you need to always realize when we are interceding, we're standing in the gap, and we're putting ourselves in between a situation, in prayer, we are then interjecting ourselves in the battle. We become a target. You need also to have people around you who are praying. But the prayers of the righteous are powerful, and they are effective, and they were with our grandson. So whatever your situation, don't be anxious. Whatever your situation, be confident that you have power. You have this same power. That your prayers will be heard and they will be effective. How do we pray? Jesus Christ himself shares with us in two locations in Scripture, in Matthew and Luke. We're going to look at Matthew. Let's turn to Matthew chapter 6, 9 through 13. This is the Lord's Prayer, is what we term it. Matthew 6, 9 through 13. Pray then like this. This is Jesus. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive those, as we also have forgiven our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. This is a model prayer that Jesus gives to us. And we should look at our prayer life, and when we're interceding for others, and follow this model. Let's look at what we can learn from him. First of all, in the model, the first and foremost point is before we can go and pray and have confidence and know that we're praying with power and that our prayers will be effective and that they will be heard, first thing, starting point, you have to have a relationship with God, the source of whom you're talking to. If you don't have a relationship, then your prayer is not going to be effective. Your prayer is not going to be powerful. To be heard, we need to have a relationship. How do we get that? Jesus, come into my heart, save my soul, forgive me of my sins. As you have died for me, I will live for you. And then you walk it out with the Holy Spirit as your guide, as your source, as the one who directs you and orders your steps. First place, when we pray, we need that relationship. If your relationship this morning has slipped, I would encourage you, pause. Don't let any minute go by. Don't let a second go by. Stop and say, Lord, forgive me. And ask for that forgiveness. Confession is made with your mouth, but repentance is action. It's turning away from that which is causing you to sin and turning towards God, turning towards the Father. Then you cry out to him in prayer. Turn away from those things that are taking you from the righteous lifestyle where God has called you. Then you can enter into this place of relationship where your prayers will also be powerful, where your prayers will also be effective. So that's the starting point. We should know and trust that we have God as our Father and acknowledge him in all his ways. Love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your mind, all of your strength. The first commandment, you shall have no other gods before me. Make sure that God is a priority in your life and that he is your Father. The Bible says we can cry out to him, Abba, Father. This is kind of unusual terms maybe for us, but Abba is really saying Daddy. If you're a dad, and your daughters, I have three. That's why the hair may be gone. It may not be the hot lava. But the three daughters, who I love with all my heart, I would do anything. I would die for them. But even today, as they find themselves, nearly all of them, in their 30s, one has a year to go. I'm not rushing you, Nate. But as they find themselves in their 30s, when I talk to them on the phone, or we happen to have the wonderful blessing to be together, and they say, Daddy, whatever. They can say Daddy, and whatever they say next, if they're asking me stuff for something, if I have the capability, I'm probably going to give it to them. Don't listen to this, girls. When I hear the word Daddy, it's that intimate place of fellowship, of communion with my girls that touches my heart. The Bible says that we cry out to Abba, Father, to Daddy, Father. We have that relationship. He wants that relationship with us. And so the starting point of prayer is to understand who we're talking to. Having a relationship with him. A relationship that isn't just like, oh God. It's like, you're a daddy and your little girl comes to you and she's crying and maybe she just skinned her knee, your heart breaks, you do something about it. When she comes to you and she's excited, she said, Daddy, look what I got on my report card. you celebrate. And not only do you celebrate and do you mourn and do you experience the same emotions and you live life with them, but whenever you hear the words daddy and whatever, if it's a problem, you want to try to fix it. If it's a celebration, you want to make it bigger. The Bible says, if we, as earthly parents, know how to give good gifts, how much more does God the Father, Abba Father, know how to give good gifts to us? Enter into relationship with Him. The relationship, if you have the relationship, prayer's going to follow, because when you're in relationship with someone you love, you want to spend time with them. You want to talk to them. You want to share with them. You want their opinion. You value what they can bring and what they do bring to your life. Starting point of prayer. Acknowledge that position. Secondly, the prayer is made up of petitions and two separate categories of petition. First, there are petitions that Jesus instructs us to do that focus on God. There's three of them. God is holy. When we are talking with God, Abba Father, we also need to understand that He is someone to be greatly revered and honored. The Bible tells us that we should do that with our earthly parents. Honor your father and mother that their days may be long. We should also honor God the Father, because He is holy. Second petition to God is God's kingdom would come here on earth as in heaven. That men would walk worthy of their callings. They would walk with what they've been ordained to do. They would do the things that God has purposed in their life, that what He designed in heaven would be physically, tangibly manifested here on earth. We should pray for that. God, despite what we see in this environment, what we see that's happening all around us, the things that look like darkness and evil are on the rise, God, your kingdom come. Because the light always causes the darkness to surrender and yield. We need to be pillars of the light. We need to pray that His kingdom, that light comes. He then instructs the third element of the petition, talking about God. God, your will be done. As we pray, we should be saying, God, not look at Jesus, how He prayed. He asked the Lord, if this cup can be taken from me as He prepared for the cross, please take it. But not my will, but your will. God, your will be done. Praying that God's will be done is the ultimate positioning of ourselves in a posture of trust that God's got it. He's got our back. He's got us covered. He's looking out for our best, that all things do work together for good. That God's will would be done, that the darkness would be exposed to the light. And truth would abound. The remaining petitions, depending on which scholar you talk to, there are three or four, we're going to talk about four today, are given relative to the petition of our needs. As we pray, we obviously are expressing, God, we have some need. He knows the need before we ask, but He's telling us we should pray this way. First of all, give us our daily bread. A request that our daily needs be met. Why does it say daily bread? And this isn't a scholarly insight, but just an insight that I'm making. But we're not really praying necessarily beyond today, but we're living in this moment. And one of the reasons I think He says it this way is because we should experience His glory, His newness, His joy every morning, every day. We shouldn't say a blanket prayer that says, oh, this covers the whole week. God, meet my needs. And that's it. Instead, we should say, God, I am dependent upon you. God, my trust is in you. My hope is in you. I don't move or breathe or have anything about my being without you. And I need to come to you daily to sustain this body, but also to sustain me spiritually. It's the expression to say, we seek Him. We seek Him first, and we seek Him daily. The next, forgive us our debts. a request to apply the blood of Jesus to our sin. Wipe away the sins. Bible says we all have sinned, we all fall short. Lord, we're tempted every day. We have the opportunity to fall every day. I believe God, through the Spirit, can give us strength to overcome that. But we should not be so proud to say, if we've fallen, we should know and say, Lord, I am posturing myself in a position of humility, and I'm begging you, God, that your mercy, your grace be applied to me. The blood of Jesus would wash away the crimson stain of sin and make me as white as snow. And we need to do that as often as necessary. It's not that we get saved every day. It's not that every time there's an altar call, you have to come up. But it is saying, examine yourself on a daily basis. Examine yourself and say, look, if I've had things in my life I've done that I need to have forgiveness, ask. The next, lead us not to temptation. I request for strength against our sinful nature, which tends to draw or suck us into situations of compromise. And really, here, it's really not God leading us into temptation, but it's our own choice, our own will, our own desire, taking us down paths we shouldn't go on. But really, this part of the prayer is saying, when we pray, we say, let me have the ability to exercise the scripture that says, resist the devil and he will flee. Deliver us then from evil. Some scholars combine these last two. It's a request expressing our reliance upon God as our source of deliverance, to deliver us from the snares of the enemy and those snares that we have created ourselves, the snares that we have created ourselves that we willfully put ourselves into harm's way in the spiritual sense. Deliver us from that evil is how we should pray. And then we should conclude with the same acknowledgement of where we started. God, you're holy. God, you're good. God, you're faithful. And it's in your Son, Jesus' name, that we pray. That's the model of our prayer. What are some powerful prayer characteristics? I want to give you three. One is that it's persistent. Two, it's consistent. Three, it's congregational. One, persistent. Luke 18:1 is the parable of the persistent widow. It's the story where Jesus is telling the disciples that a widow just keeps coming back and coming back and coming back and coming back. And in the parable, it's like she almost becomes a nuisance. And finally, the person she's persisting with gives in and says, give her what she needs. And Jesus is saying, when we pray, we should be like that. We should not be moved by situation, but we should continually ask. We should be persistent. We should persevere when the answer doesn't come immediately or in the way of context in which we think. We should know he's a good father. We should know that he's dispatching angels on our behalf. We should understand and rely on the scripture as being true, that when Daniel prayed and had to wait 21 days, he seemed like the answer was never coming. But after 21 days, he came, and the Lord said to Daniel, I sent angels on the first day. You don't understand, Daniel. There's a war in the heavenlies. A war. The enemy of darkness sent a whole army to buffet the response. You don't know what might be happening in the supernatural. But you need to trust and believe and know and hear, persevere, have persistence. Secondly, the powerful prayer characteristic of being consistent. 1 Thessalonians 5:17, Romans 12:12, Colossians 4:2, pray without ceasing. Be constant regardless of circumstances and be steadfast. A healthy lifestyle of prayer is to constantly be within it. We should not just be praying when we have a need, but as we're driving down the road, we should be thanking, saying, God, thank you for this day that you've given me. When we wake up every morning, the first breath out of our mouth should be, Lord, I thank you for this new day. We have so much to be thankful for. We have so much to constantly talk about with the Lord. We should constantly be in prayer because it's a relationship. Be consistent regardless of what we see ourselves in circumstances. The things that would move us physically, we need to say, I'm going to be steadfast. I'm going to be steady. I'm going to walk through this because I know I have a God that if I remain consistent, he is my source. He is the great I am. He is my solution. So we need to pray without ceasing. Be constant, regardless of circumstances, be steadfast. Then we need to be congregational. The powerful prayer characteristic of being in community. The Bible says, don't forsake the gathering together. And this is where intercession really comes in. There are times where you don't have the word to say, and the Spirit says, I will intercede with groanings that you cannot even understand. But he's also put you around people who you need to have a community of prayer around you. That through the prayers of many, it says in 2 Corinthians 1:11, that blessings will abound. Paul asked for the Corinthian church to pray for him and Timothy in order that their ministry would be successful. He prayed to them in a place where they were being put in prison. He prayed with them from a place where he was being persecuted. But he said, I know our God is faithful, but I want you to stand with me so that the blessings of many will be seen because of the congregational intercessory response that came in prayer. We experienced this with our own grandson. As a community that's not connected in any other way but through us and our grandchildren came together to pray, there was a response that was magnificent, that was powerful. The power of prayer is promised. I'm going to go through, just bounce through several scriptures here. First of all, foremost, for the forgiveness of sins. James 5 and 15. Prayer of faith will save the sick, also in James 5. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. We've already talked about that. And whatever you ask in faith, you will receive. Now, you can't just ask for crazy things. It's how you align with God. But what happens is if you're in a relationship with God Almighty, then your will is yielded to His will. You're praying the Lord's Prayer. Thy will be done. Thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. That's your prayer. That's your heart. If you pray that way, if you walk that way, the power of prayer is promised. And it says, whatever you ask will be answered, will be given to you when you're in alignment with my will, when you're in relationship with me. Can you imagine if our mind had totally been transformed to a place where our thoughts are equal, aligned with His thoughts? And what we ask for, we know we would receive. The thing is we would become not selfish at all. But we would be looking to others. The Bible gives us two great commands. Love the Lord your God with all your heart. The second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. If we're in God's perfect will, we're going to be walking in that place. Walking, acknowledging the goodness of God. Praying for those things, for His kingdom to come. His will to be done. Praying for our neighbor and the things that they have need of in their life. Interceding on their behalf. The power of prayer is a wonderful thing. The power of prayer is something that has been experienced by all of us. You hear the stories about the praying grandma. You hear the stories about someone praying for us. And just this past week, we received a Facebook message from a young man that was in our lives. And we haven't had a lot of communication, but we love him. He's in our heart. And he made a comment about words that we said 15, 20 years ago, a long time ago. I lose track, I'm getting older. But it was powerful. And we prayed for that young man. We continue to pray for him. There's power in prayer. There's unity that can happen in prayer. There's fulfillment of calling. There's healing for the sick. There's a mending of a broken heart. There's financial release from the windows of heaven being opened. All of these things are what we do through prayer to get access to God the Father, Jehovah Jireh, through Jesus' Son, and through the Holy Spirit. So today, I just want to pray over you quickly as we conclude, because prayer is relational, it's powerful, it's effective, and it shows God's providence. So Lord, I just today would pray over everyone who can hear the sound of my voice, Lord God, that you would stir up within them, Lord God, the desire, the passion to seek you first, to have a relationship with you. Lord God, that they would want to communicate to you in prayer. And Father, for those who don't have the words to say, I'd ask that your spirit would flow into them right now in Jesus' name. Lord, I intercede for them on their behalf. Lord God, I stand in the gap to pray, Lord God, for them. And for those, Lord God, who are lost, who are prodigals, who have strayed away, Lord God, I just ask that you be with them. You bring them home. Lord God, you bring them back to you. Lord God, for those who have never entered into a relationship, Lord God, expose their need. Bring someone across their path, Lord God, to tell them the good news, for them to receive and hear. Lord, I ask that you strengthen all of our lives with prayer, with intercession for others, for people who are interceding for us. For all of those who are intercessors, Lord God, I pray a special blessing upon them. Lord God, touch them, protect them, guard them, Lord God, in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you. We thank you for your goodness, for your holiness, for your power, for you allowing us the privilege to come before you in relationship and cry out to you as Abba, Father, whatever it is that our need is. And so today we just praise you. We lift your name on high and give you the glory. And it's in your Son Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Be blessed. Have a great week.